Hello again from not-so-sunny Oklahoma. A question arrived in the email today, and it's a variation on one that comes quite often in various guises. The questioner said, "Do you ever get depressed anymore?" And any and all moods certainly can arise. The organism still has its chemical design, so to speak, and the ever-changing chemical design. It still has the DNA, that some call hardwiring, that gives a sense of robotic movement in reaction to various stimulus. And so the machinery remains in the clear seeing that there's no entity as such, no separate individual entity with any independent nature or any independent power to cause or prevent anything. The natural seeing is that the no entity-ness, there's nothing to take delivery. That is to say, there is no taking on board any mood that may arise or anything else that may arise as, quote, mine. All the notions of ownership have faded into the mist, and they were simply a product of what one of my gurus, the very great Advaita sage Wayne Lickerman, calls the FSA, the false sense of authorship. The false sense of authorship would say, I'm depressed, and I should not be depressed. Even after all, I've been on a spiritual path for 30 years, or 3 years, or 12 years, whatever length of time, and so I should know better. I should know that who I am is the space in which life occurs. I should know that. And that is a product of the false sense of authorship. And I love something Wayne said recently. He said, it's a hope for a better past. Because if you really look, what there is right now is only the past. The present is not graspable. The moment it's grasped, it becomes a concept. It becomes completely conceptual. Your experience is the experiencing, moment by moment by moment by moment, and in that experiencing, there is no true experiencer. The experiencer is a product of that false sense of separation that arises as the false sense of authorship or the false sense of being the playwright of the play or the designer of the dance. You're not the choreographer. You're not the writer. You're not the author. However, for me to say that is just an assertion that won't really kind of do much of anything in all likelihood unless there's a looking there. And the looking there, where you are, is okay. I assume that things could and should be different than they are. But is that true? I assume that I'm the author, I'm the designer, I'm the playwright, but is that true? Is there actually an authoring entity, or is there simply this unfolding of the manifest appearance with kind of out of itself, with no entity in charge, and with no vestige of any, quote, individual control? So the core question in all of this, of course, is any of my assumptions, are they true? Is it true that I'm separate? Is it true that I'm the body? Is it true that I am the thought? Is it true that I'm in the body? Is it true? I'm not saying it is or isn't true. I'm suggesting that the looking, if it resonates there, might take hold. A function of totality arising as a looking. There is no author of the looking either, in my view, but again, that's too pat an answer to take on board and turn into the new Advaita truth. I really hope you don't do that. I often say, don't believe anything I say. Don't believe or accept. Don't deny or accept. Let the looking happen as the natural course of this apparent process that unfolds in a very small but somewhat significant number of cases. So, the assumption, I'm me, is it true? The assumption, I am, is that true? Or did Nisargadatta Maharaj have a point when he said, even the I am is ignorance? And examining that, not accepting or denying, but examining. And then looking and saying, well, okay, I say these things, I listen to these things, I speak these things. I seem to know these things or not know these things. I seem to not understand what's being pointed to, and I want to understand it. Who is it that is claiming that it could understand? And a deeper question might be, what is it that is animating the either looking or not looking? The stimulus response of an organism, what animates the organism? Because whatever that is, if you take it away, they will come and take the organism away because it very quickly becomes a great nuisance, stinks up the room. So without that animating life force, without that energy, without that some call Shakti, the organism's a corpse. So this energy that arises around the age of 2.5 as a sense of, I like to call it a combination of energy contraction and ideation. I mean, it would be really nice if the only thing that was causing suffering was the idea of being separate, being a me, a person apart from the whole. That would be really great. But it is more than an idea. It is a sense of contraction. That's why I love what Wayne calls it, false sense of authorship. And the false sense of authorship, what's the key? It's false. It has no power to do anything. All this false sense of authorship, which arises in virtually every human being around the age of between 2 and 3, is a sense that I am the controlling force in my life. And to use Wayne's phrase, a false sense of authorship, that I am the author of the doing of the organisms. Human organisms do all kinds of stuff. You might call them human doings rather than human beings, but that's another conversation for another time. But the doing goes on. The question is, what or who authors and empowers the doing? So there's a doing right now happening here. I am speaking into a camera to an audience of, I don't know how many, but certainly one. If you're watching, there's certainly an audience of one. So I'm doing that, you're not. But what is the authoring force? Where's the playwright? Who wrote the script? Is there a script? I'm not reading from a script. Yet, there's words happening, actions happening. Deeds are certainly being done. Now, we can talk about, as the Buddha said, deeds are being done, but there's no individual doer thereof. But I think what the doer, what the author, what the Buddha was really pointing to was that there is no designer entity in the organism that is causing the doing. Now, a friend of mine once said, if you really want to make someone suffer, convince them that they're responsible for what they do and what they have and their lives as they are. Because in this seeing, responsibility as a concept goes straight out the window. If you're not the author, if you're not the designer, if you ain't the playwright, then nothing that has happened through you or to you is your fault or anyone else's. This is really good news. It's not your fault. You know, it's not your fault that you stole money when you were 9 years old. It's not your fault that you screwed your friend's wife. It's not your fault any of the stuff that you did. What you did was done by source or God or the force or whatever label you want to hang on to the impervious eternal energy which causes everything, apparently. Ultimately, you see that there is no cause. Cause itself is another story that we tell in order to explain the unexplainable. So, what's all this about? Nothing much of anything. Rather than simply perhaps asking a question deeper and in a way you've never asked it before, I assume I'm me. Is it true? I assume I am the cause of the events of, quote, my life. Is it true that it's my life? Or is it life's life? Famously in the Bhagavad Gita, the Indian scripture, Krishna has said to Arjuna, who's lamenting about killing relatives and friends across the battlefield and having to do that and in despair because he doesn't want to do that. He's a moral man. And Krishna says, I've already killed them. You are not the author of the killing. I am. And so even that, of course, is only a pointer which falls apart when the seeing is clear that there's no separate entity anywhere to do or not do anything. It was an assumption, and to challenge the assumption is simply to ask about any assumption, especially the core assumption, I am me, and it is my job to manage my life. Is it true? Is it true? Notice that if the answer comes, well, yes, it's true. Well, who said that? The same entity which we're asking you to question its truth. So, yes, it's true. Well, is that true? Take it deeper and deeper and deeper, you think. But, you know, now we'll have to see if that actually happens, and if it does happen, if it bears any fruit. In the meantime, in between time, ain't we got fun? Thanks for watching. I love you all very much. Have a great now. That's all we got. Oh, and feel free to write or call if questions come up and you'd like to talk about your own search. At the end of this video, there will be a slide with the contact information on it. You're free to get in touch or not. Be well.